and Pediatrics, Dr. Karthik Nagesh. You know, I know Karthik for the last 3 decades, and interestingly, he did his training in Delhi, and as he said 2 minutes before you people all joined, that main Delhi wala hoon, dil se Delhi wala hi rahunga. So it is such a pleasure, sir. I mean, I connected him with him after a gap of a few years because I was not too well. So I sort of dormant for the last 5-6 years. So welcome, sir, for the thing. And thank you. And our speaker for today on torch infections is Dr. Pankaj Garg, who's the incoming president of the IAP Delhi, a neonatologist, our own product from Gangaram Hospital, one of the brightest stars of Gangaram Hospital in the field of neonatology. His USP, as they say, is his availability for any kind of work which you assign him, and also availability for taking care of patients. Not only that, he has an extensive network of people who refer him the patients much more than anybody else in the field of in the department of neonatology. And it is, this network is not developed in a day or two. It requires a lot of effort, a lot of pain, and you have to be available not only to the patient but also to the doctors who refer you the patients. So friends, I would request Dr. Pankaj Garg to start off with his lecture, and then we can move on. And sir, Dr. Karthik and Dr. Lalan Bharti, can you please, you can even interrupt the lecture in between to ask a few questions or clarify a few things. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, Dr. Naveen also is on platform. So, Dr. Naveen Bajaj, sir.
Bajaj is here, sir.
Maybe.
Yeah, it's my pleasure to be on this podium with all these luminaries. But also another luminary we have here is Dr. Naveen Bajaj, who is the chairperson of the prestigious neonatology chapter of the IAP. We are really very proud to have him here, and he's one of the most astute neonatologists in the northern part of India. We all know him, yes, as a fantastic, yes, neonatologist. Thank you. And again, I will again reiterate, I'm so proud to be now moderating the session which our astute neonatologist Pankaj is going to speak on. Just to set the context a little bit, congenital infections or torch infections, as they were called earlier, is one of the most vexing kind of problems to look after. Diagnosis is difficult. There are multiple pathogens involved. And of course, early diagnosis is the key to real treatment. If you delay the treatment, long-term complications and immediate complications occur. And of course, very difficult to diagnose, high index of suspicion you have to have. So I'm sure Dr. Pankaj is going to do great justice to this topic, which is a very frustrating topic to look after and to speak about also. Thank you so much. We welcome you, Dr. Pankaj.
Thank you, Dr. Karthik, Dr. Naveen, Dr. Lallan, and Dr. Anupam for giving me this responsibility, and special thanks to IAP Delhi, who in collaboration with the Institute of Child Health, Gangaram Hospital, is doing this excellent program. We are having faculty lecture, we are having case discussions 2 times per week, which is not an easy thing to do if you have to do it for the whole 52 weeks. So the teams have been really doing good job. And I really wish that we keep on getting more and more participants into these meetings. So I just shared my slides. Right. I hope my screen is visible and I'm audible to the attendees.
Yes.
Yes, yes, sir.
Right. So as the topic says, torch infections, as Dr. Karthik very rightly said, we are very tuned to look after bacterial infections, fungal infections, and we treat them on day-to-day basis. But as far as these infections are concerned, they are not that common. Though we think about them or we feel that they're around a lot of time, we feel that we suspect them many times, but because of issues of diagnosis, we are not able to diagnose them in as many numbers as we are diagnosing our E. coli, Klebsiella, Acinetobacter, fungal infections, corona, or other infections. But the good news is that now PCR technology has become so common thanks to Corona. Now all laboratories, including our own hospital, we have got such a good PCR-based technologies that we are able to diagnose many more torch group of infections than we have done in last 27 years. So last 3 years have been really good in making diagnosis possible. So what do you mean by torch? It stands for toxoplasmosis, T-O is for others. A lot of others like Treponema pallidum, the syphilis, varicella zoster, parvovirus, HIV, rubella virus, cytomegalovirus, and herpes simplex virus. This the torch word comes for T, toxo, others, R, rubella, cytomegalovirus, and herpes. As it's very, very clear that it is not possible to discuss about all these infections. So what I have done is that I have made some presentation which is common to all of them. And then I will be speaking something more on toxo, rubella, cytomegalovirus, and herpes group of viruses. So first of all, the important thing here is these are, though many of these infections can be acquired later on in life also, but as far as newborns are concerned, we are mainly concerned about these infections. If the mother gets this disease, it may be a primary disease or it may be reactivation of the disease. And then because the fetus is inside the mother at that time, it is transplacentally spread to the fetus. And because at that time, fetus is developing. And these, whether it is toxo, which is a parasite, or the rubella, which is a virus, herpes is a virus, cytomegalovirus is a virus. So they may go into the fetus. And at that time, the fetal organogenesis is happening. So it may damage the fetus structures, which may have sequelae later on in life. That is the most important part of it. We know that in bacterial sepsis, till the time you get, you are diagnosing them immediately. Suppose your baby is getting sick, you immediately send a culture. You diagnose bacterial infection, you start antibiotics. The bacteria has not got enough time to damage your brain, you damage your other systems. But here, without the knowledge of the neonatologist, the fetus is being affected and the system may collapse and they may get into many sequelae. Now, it's not that all babies will get infection. It will all depend, not all babies will get damage. It will depend on the gestational age. As very correctly, if it happens in first 20 weeks, more so in the first trimester, damage is going to be more. Virulence of organisms, we know that certain virulence may be different, like cytomegalovirus, you may be asymptomatic, though infected, but Treponema pallidum, syphilis, you may be getting more disease, more significant disease. If the placenta is damaged, the viral load or the pathogen load may be high to the fetus. And if the mother is very severely affected, that means her load of the virus or the bacteria is more, then also the baby may be affected more. So usually they are not very virulent. So it may cause abortions, but usually these infections are of low virulence and placenta is constituting a protective immunological barrier. That is why many infections may be there, but still it's not that everybody who's infected is going to be damaged. And immature fetus may lack the immunological mechanisms or may have immunological tolerance. So baby may get some disease and may not show you any infection at the time of birth. So you may or may not have clinical evidence of infection. So let us look at this diagram, which is more systematic. Maternal infection, which leads to bloodstream infection. Bloodstream infection may or may not invade the fetus or placenta. If there is no fetal or placental infection, then there is no effect on growth or viability and the baby is spared. But if the placenta is infected, still your fetus may or may not be infected. So if fetus is infected, then the effects on growth and viability, embryonic death absorption can happen, abortion, stillbirth can happen, premature baby can be there, or a term baby can be there. And if baby is there, then it can affect their growth. We know that many babies will be born small for date, or maybe having developmental abnormalities, maybe having sensory neural deafness later on in life, congenital diseases, which we'll all discuss. But at the same time, still baby may remain normal, especially some of infections you are infected like cytomegalovirus, rubella, but it's not that every newborn will be diseased. If the infection you may acquire in postnatal phase also, like cervical secretions, like breast milk, like you can get it from things which happen in the NICU, like blood transfusions. And from that postnatal infections also, Some of the infections can lead to progressive tissue damage, leading to sequelae or death. If you eradicate the virus, then definitely there may not be the apparent disease, but sequelae of infection can occur later on in life. Like classical example is cytomegalovirus, which can cause sensorineural disease or deafness later on in life. So pathogenesis is progressive tissue destruction. Is seen in many infections. Like I said, it's seen in rubella, HSV, CMV, toxoplasmosis, and syphilis, and definitely sequelae can be there. So now this, up till now, I've been talking a lot of theory part, but let us see how do they present. They may present like small for date. Usually they are born small. Their weight for gestation is less than 2 standard deviation, maybe even smaller at times. They may present with hepatosplenomegaly, which is a common presentation. Neonatal cold stasis. See, unconjugated hyperbole is there in many newborns, but this group of infections present with cold stasis with a direct fraction of more than 1 milligram percent or more than 20%, whichever is more. So we know that 1 milligram percent is more or less taken as the indicator of neonatal cold stasis. They may present with pneumonia also, petechy because of thrombocytopenia. They may present with meningoencephalitis also. Now, let us look at some distinctive features which may be able to tell you, because all the features which I discussed before, like these, are common to all these infections, like Torch group infections. But some features may be distinctive, like intracranial calcifications. We know it is more commonly seen in toxoplasmosis, which is like diffuse calcification, CMV, which is like more periventricular calcification. Cataract is seen in rubella very commonly. It is seen also in herpes simplex virus. Chorioretinitis is seen in toxoplasmosis and CMV infection. Osteitis is seen in rubella and syphilis. Congenital heart disease is typical of rubella, like PDA with peripheral pulmonary stenosis. Microcephaly is seen commonly in CMV, while toxoplasmosis usually results in hydrocephalus. You may have vesicular lesions, which are typical of herpes, varicella zoster, and sometimes they may be seen in syphilis also. So this is the most important, and the most things have happened in this field, how to diagnose. So when we were students, not very far from now, serology was the only thing which was available to us. And we were always debating whether we should be doing it or not, because we used to see a lot of false positive. There was a time when there was a thought process that all small for date babies, you should do total IgM in the code. And if it is high, you look for infections, which is not is a good strategy, because total IgM titer may or may not be high, even if you have got infected or not infected. Then specific IgM like toxo IgM, rubella IgM, CMV IgM. The problem is that except for rubella IgM, which is still some way, suggestive of rubella infections. Other IgMs like toxo, CMV, they are very non-specific. They have a lot of false positives and there are a lot of false negatives also. Specific IgG, we know that if the mother is infected, she may be carrying IgG and they will be transferred from the mother to the baby. So how do you know that they are transferred or their baby is making its own IgG? So there are two ways. One, that you take two titers, 2 to 4 weeks apart. If it is rising titer, it may be suggestive that baby is making its own IgG. Other is you look at avidity testing. Avidity means how strong antibody you have. So if it is a low avidity, it is a recent infection. So it may be neonatal. But if it is a high avidity, it's an old antibody, which is maternal. So we always say old friends, they bind better. So that is why avidity, if it is old antibody, they have got high avidity. If it is new antibody, which is a neonatal antibody, usually it's a low avidity. So many laboratories may have avidity for CMV or rubella. Toxoplasmosis avidity is not available in usually centers. So, but it can be a good guide along with IgM and a rising IgG. So no one test can be really suggestive of this, but yes, in a combination, specific IgG, IgM also, rising and IgG also, and avidity, which is low avidity, is suggestive of recent infection in the newborn. PCR. Now, this is the game changer. Now, we have got panels, toxo, CMV, rubella, parvo, herpes panel. So, it is done in amniotic fluid. It can be done in urine. It can be done in blood. This is not very expensive. It is done routinely in Gangaram Hospital for the last 5-6 years. We are doing it. It is of great help, as Dr. Anupam was saying. It's a part of perinatal medicine. Genetic lab is doing it. The each PCR individually may be costing something like 3,000 rupees. So a lot of diagnosis of rubella, CMV has been possible. Parvo has been possible. We have not been able to see a lot of toxo and herpes in our samples. But yes, CMV, rubella and parvo we have seen in the amniotic fluid also, and we also seen in urine. Viral cultures, nobody is doing that. And with the PCR coming in, viral cultures are becoming less fashionable. It will take at least 4 weeks before you really say viral culture is negative. So I'm not aware that we are not sending viral cultures as a routine. And maybe it's only for research purpose that if you want to do viral cultures. Treatment, isolation, because whether it is rubella or it is CMV, they may stay in circulation for a very long period of time. The babies may be excreting it in urine. So it's a good strategy to keep these babies in isolation and make sure that no pregnant or recently pregnant nurse or doctor is taking care of that, or isolation precautions have to be taken very well. Supportive treatment is really be helpful in all, but there's specific treatment available for toxoplasmosis and CMV and herpes. So for rubella, there's no specific treatment available, but for others, there may be specific treatment also available. Let us look at some of the infections. Toxoplasmosis, as you know, is stand for Toxoplasma gondii, usually from canine or cats, the root of infection. It is it latent encysted organism may persist for life. And rate of transmission, that is very important, that if rate of transmission varies, if it is a primary infection, rate of transmission is very high, 75%, but it may be secondary infection, then rate of infection is very less. Clinical features, 1/3 are generalized and 2/3 are neurological disease like cytomegalovirus or hepatosplenomegaly and others. The classical triad is hydrocephalus, chorioretinitis, and intracranial calcification. Let me admit that in my newborn career, neonatology career of last 30 years in Gangaram Hospital, I've only diagnosed one congenital toxoplasmosis. So it is not very common because we are not very canine friendly. Like we don't have cats as pets usually, which are the most source of infection. But if you have a triad of hydrocephalus, chorioretinitis, intracranial calcification, you should suspect toxoplasmosis. Something like this, which you can see like calcification here, these are intracerebral calcifications. Why we need to diagnose it? Because it's a treatable disease, but for that you need an early diagnosis. PCR, as I said before, you have PCR available. You can do it in amniotic fluid. You can also do it in blood. And other possibilities, IgG positive with low avidity, specific IgM, rising titers, then if it is infecting the mother, you can use paramycin. As you know, pyrimethamine, which is a drug of choice for newborn, cannot be used in mother because the anti-folate drug. So paramycin, 1 gram every 8 hourly to prevent fetal infection if it is diagnosed in the mother. And screening programs are not justified for our country because of low disease burden, but it is in high endemic countries like France, it is a screening program also exists. So if fetus is infected, definitely we use pyrimethamine, sulfadiazine, and leucovorin, and diagnosis through PCR. Still, you have to look for serial ultrasound for evidence of organ damage. And negative serology definitely is helpful in ruling out this infection. But if that newborn you suspected, you proved by PCR, which is possible, then you have to treat it. Treatment is for 1 year. So you should be sure that you're treating toxoplasmosis because you need to use pyrimethamine, which is an antifolate drug, which you use 1 mg/kg 12 hourly for 2 days and then 1 mg/day for 2 to 6 months, plus sulfadiazine, plus folinic acid. It's not folic acid. It is leucovorin, which cancer patients are using because you're using antifolate drugs, pyrimethamine. Newborn is also growing very fast. That is why you need leucovorin, and treatment is for 1 year. You may use prednisolone, especially if there is severe chorioretinitis or CSF protein values are high. So on those situations, you can use prednisolone, but otherwise 1 year treatment of pyrimethamine, sulfadiazine and folinic acid. Postnatal testing, the same as I said, you need to do serology, PCR and complete evaluation has to be done. Prognosis is still not very good. They may lead to stillbirth and perinatal death. Congenital infections also, there may be mortality associated with this. And sequelae, like ophthalmological sequelae, like microphthalmia can come, auditory, neurodevelopmental impairments can come because of hydrocephalus and calcifications. And you know, the prevention is the key here, because we have to avoid cat litter exposure, undercooked beef, washing fruits and vegetables, and that can really prevent toxoplasmosis. I'm not spending much time on toxoplasmosis because of not very common in our part of the world. We'll be discussing more about rubella and cytomegalovirus. Rubella is also becoming less common because of vaccinations. But if mother gets rubella up to second trimester, you can get congenital rubella syndrome. And congenital rubella syndrome is, since PAHO said that in 2005, the Pan American Health Organization has already said in 2005 that there is no CRS happening in Pan America, like North and South America, but it is still a problem with us. So we can get severe cases, mental retardation, microcephaly, cataract, deafness, and heart defect like PDA with peripheral perineuritis stenosis. Frequency is inversely with the gestation. Earlier gestation, like first trimester, 12 weeks, you get very high chances, 70-80%. So if any mother gets fever, get rash, or get occipital or post-auricular lymphadenopathy, you can always get a rubella IgM done. If IgM is positive, it may be suggestive of rubella infection in the mother. Then ultimately, as I said before, it's not that all infected rubella mother getting rubella baby will be infected. It is only 70-80%. Still 30% may be spared. So how to prove the diagnosis in the fetus? You have to do an amniotic fluid PCR for rubella. Some other situation can be the mother got vaccinated MMR, got pregnant within 3 months of MMR or MR or rubella vaccine. And then you have to do the same procedure of using cytomegalovirus, this rubella PCR in the amniotic fluid. Later on, it becomes lesser, 30-54% in 13-14 weeks, and much lesser later on. So normally born baby may be absolutely normal, but may have late onset sequelae, like cataract, which is possible, like PDA, which is possible, not diagnosed at that time, but usually you're able to see some small for dead babies. Sometimes it is transient, the problem may be resolved, but sometimes it may persist. And if you're able to diagnose, then deafness, cataract, mental retardation, diabetes mellitus 1, and hypogammaglobulinemia may be a possibility in these patients. So as I tried to show that you can have cataract, like this patient has bilateral cataract, this patient has cataract along with microphthalmia. These are blueberry lesions, and this patient has got microcephaly as well as rash. So screening of pregnant women by positive IgM or rising titer in paired IgG can be a good strategy. Lab diagnosis is IgM for rubella is something very, very specific, but rising titer along with IgM positive gives you a lot of idea. You can isolate virus, which is not done now. What is done is PCR, which I said can be done in amniotic fluid, can be done in urine also. As I said, there's no specific treatment, but isolation is recommended. And definitely they can keep on excreting this rubella virus for a year and maybe later. Even cataract sample, which has been removed, have shown that it contains rubella. So prevention is through prenatal screening. Prenatal, before you are pregnant, the mother is screened for rubella IgG. If she is negative, vaccination is done, and then pregnancy is after 3 months. Then if you get IgG negative, but the woman is already pregnant, then you don't want to do anything. You just continue the pregnancy. And if the woman delivers normal baby, then postpartum vaccination can be done so that in next pregnancy that can be prevented. Immunoglobulin also have been used with variable success. Let us look at CMV, because CMV, we all of us are seeing more commonly now. It's highly prevalent. It is acquired in utero, natally also at birth, because of cervical secretion, postnatally also because of milk and because of blood transfusions. Primary maternal infection leads to more fetal infections, like 30-50%. Secondary maternal infection less often, but does not mean will not lead to disease. Disease can be there. But the problem here is that it can be perinatal infection also through at the time of birth. It can be through breast milk also, and can be through blood products also. So how do I know it is congenital? The cutoff is 3 weeks. If you're able to see the symptoms or diagnosis before 3 weeks of birth, after birth, it is congenital. After 3 weeks, it can be perinatal, because as I said, breast milk incubation period is 3-24 weeks, and blood transfusion, the incubation period is 3-12 weeks. So after 3 weeks, It can be through breast milk. It can be through blood transfusion. Why we are worried? Why we want to diagnose congenital? Because congenital infections are likely to have more sequelae and will require much longer duration of treatment compared to perinatal CMV infection. The prenatal findings can be oligohydramnios, poly, non-immune hard drops, ascites, IGR, microcephaly, sometimes hydrocephalus, but usually intracranial calcifications, which are periventricular. Hepatosplenomegaly and intrahepatic calcification also can be seen. Cholestasis, petechiae, hepatosplenomegaly, IGR is common to all TORCH. Microcephaly, chorioretinitis is more specific or CMV. So these are the babies. This is the baby showing osteitis. Baby showing blueberry muffin, which is like intradermal erythropoiesis, perivascular infiltrate in retina, which all can be seen. And we have seen all of them. CMV is still very common and we are able to diagnose them. Neurological sequelae are the most common problems. More commonly, if symptomatic congenital CMV is there, but asymptomatic infections also can have sequelae. That is why if you got sensory neural deafness later on in life, some part of it may be because of CMV, which is not diagnosed in neonatal period. So sensory hearing loss occurs in 50% of symptomatic and 15% of asymptomatic infection. And the worst thing is that disease keeps on worsening over time. So we have seen children with the first BERA done at the time of discharge with CMV, symptomatic infection was normal. And then later on, when you repeat it 3 months and 6 months and 1 year, they become abnormal. So sensory neural deafness may evolve over a period of time. Sequelae, cranial CT is a good predictor of sequelae. Abnormal CT gives you a lot of jitters because it is likely to have sequelae later on in life. And it has also been shown abnormal CT, 90% babies will have at least one sequelae. And normal CT also 30% babies will get some sequelae. Only 1 in 17 newborns with normal CT have IQ less than 70. But abnormal CT IQs are poorer. This is periventral calcification, as you can see, compared to what we see in toxoplasmosis, which is more scattered. This is more periventricular calcification. Diagnosis, IgM testing in mother does not have any value because I've got false positive and negative. In newborn, IgM positive, rising titers and low avidity may give you an idea. But now CMV is easily available and most laboratories, in amniotic fluid, you can test it. In urine, other blood, CSF, saliva also can be done. But the best sample is urine or at the best saliva. Blood is not a good sample because isolation in blood in immunocompetent host does not necessarily indicate infection or disease. And if you isolate it from amniotic fluid, urine, saliva, blood, milk, or other body products, it is more likely that baby is getting infection. Especially amniotic fluid is more congenital infection. Other infection like urine, saliva, blood may be acquired or congenital both. Treatment, we know that right now, all of us are using valganciclovir, which is an oral drug, which is you need to treat for symptomatic, especially moderate to severe, you definitely need to treat. And newborn period, if something is presenting, it is usually moderate to severe only. So with or without CNS involvement, treatment remains same 6 months. This 6 months treatment has shown audiological like hearing improvement as well neurodevelopmental outcome improvement at 2 to 4 years. You need to do absolute neutrophil count every weekly for 6 weeks and then at 8 weeks and then monthly. About 1/5 of patients on valganciclovir will develop absolute neutrophil count less than 500, in which you need to stop it and then restart it after some time. SGPT or liver function monthly, dose is 16 mg per kg per dose twice a day and for 6 months. It is a very good drug, does not have many side effects. Unfortunately, not available as syrup, it is available as capsule from Cipla. You have to get it made from pharmacy and that can be done. Ganciclovir is, if the patient has got pneumonitis or has got hepatitis or encephalitis, then you may start a ganciclovir, or the child is not tolerating feeds, then you may start it for 2 weeks. And then if the baby starts improving, then you can come back to ganciclovir. There's a thinking behind that you may start IV, do a blood test. If the blood test is negative, then only you start ganciclovir. That is very much debated. We can safely say that after 2 weeks of ganciclovir, ganciclovir is the treatment of choice for next 6 months. Urine shedding shouldn't persist for a very long period of time. So that is why the infection can spread to the caregivers. Repeat BERA testing, as I said, it's an evolving sensory neural deafness. It's important. And neurological follow-up of these patients is important because brain sequelae in form of neurodevelopmental outcome abnormalities can happen. Last but not the least, the herpes simplex, that also we don't see very commonly, but yes, it is a very bad disease, can have high mortality. That is where it needs discussion. First half of pregnancy, if you get herpes simplex, there are more stillborns, but births rarely causes fetal infections. Intrapartum, 85%. So usually the infection here is more like intrapartum. Intrauterine is only less than 5%. Intrapartum, that means at the time of delivery, you got active herpetic lesions, especially in the genitalia, which is herpes simplex virus 2. So it is herpes simplex virus 2, which is more responsible for penile HSV, and less often herpes simplex virus 1, which is normally seen in the perioral region. But HSV 1 infections are more likely to disseminate and result in fatal outcome. So HSV 2, because it's perineal, causes more disease, but HSV 1, which is perioral, does not cause much disease. But if it causes, it is a worse disease because it can disseminate and cause fatal disease. So less than 40% of mothers who newborn with proven HFC infection has history of herpetic lesions. More commonly with primary, as we know that herpes keeps on coming again and again. Recurrent infections risk is low. Trauma, which now we are using ECG, EEG electrodes in the scalp. So if you have herpetic lesion there and you also you are using the electrodes, trauma can cause, and trauma can increase the likelihood of neonatal infections. Most newborns are normal at birth, but some of them by 6 to 10 days may have skin, eye, mouth disease, like we look for herpes, 20% of them. Disseminated disease with or without CNS involvement is seen by 5 to 7 days. That means you have to wait for symptoms to come in 50%. CNS disease comes little later, 16, 17 days in 30%. Less than 50% have fever, and 30 to 40% have skin lesions at the time of onset. So you may not have skin lesion and later on. That is why whenever you have disseminated disease like CNS involvement, bad disease, you always tend to investigate for herpes, because it can be done now. PCR can be done in CSF also, and you can diagnose it. These are the lesions. You all know that they are typical herpetic lesions. And CSF studies also reveal lymphocytic pleocytosis, elevated protein, which comes later. A disseminated disease can be really fulminant and can be like any other bacterial sepsis with multi-organ dysfunction. Rapid diagnosis available by DFA testing of specimen from skin lesions. Normally, we are not doing that. Cultures are also normally not being done. What is being done is PCR. PCR now it is possible, and that also is good enough test, and it also gives you a lot of prognostic importance. Why we want to diagnose it? Because we have a drug available like acyclovir, which is a drug of choice, 60 mg per kg per day, 20 mg per kg per dose, 8 hourly for 14 to 21 days. And then you consider CSF PCR at the end of therapy for newborns with CNS involvement to make it sure that CSF PCR, though we know that PCR is negative before you stop. If mother has got active genital lesions, then definitely you don't deliver by vaginal route. Use the LSCS rate, LSCS. And if the baby is born through LSCS and is a low-risk setting, it's a full-term baby, then you can just obtain mucosal cultures at 24, 48 hours. And you educate the family about signs and symptoms of neonatal HSV disease. And if the cultures are negative, you can be discharged, because the disease comes 5 to 7 days later. But if in high-risk settings, like if the mucosal cultures are positive at 24, 48 hours, or if it's a preterm baby and there's symptoms which come up, then you have to start treatment in the frame of acyclovir. Usually we'll be starting acyclovir, sending the sample. A sample comes positive, you continue. Sample comes negative, you stop. Prognosis, overall mortality is high because it's encephalitis. And disease which is limited only to skin, mouth, eye can disseminate to viscera or brain in more than 70% of cases without therapy. So herpes in neonatal period of should always be treated with acyclovir. Localized CNS disease, mortality is little lower, but this risk factor for sequelae is high, 20 to 60% mortality. So we know that we should be careful. Even if it is only skin, eye, mouth disease, you should be scared that it may disseminate, and you should start acyclovir at that stage. So I tried to finish my presentation in 40 minutes. The purpose is that we want some discussion around this. I'm sure all of us are seeing these infections courtesy the diagnosis, which is possible through the PCR technology. This group is a diverse group of infections, but why they have been clubbed together, because they have common symptoms like small foot, hepatosplenomegaly, cholestasis, petechiae, cataract, hearing deficit, chorioretinitis, PDA. So they have common symptoms which you, looking at a symptom, you're not sure that this is this infection. So you know that the diagnosis also is a similar way. Now they become packages. You have PCR package for torch infection in which you are taxing toxo, rubella, CMV, parvo, syphilis in the same package. So there's similar way of diagnosis is like serology also. But yes, as I said, serology is not the best way to diagnose. PCR is a better way. But yes, for rubella, IgM can have some value. And IgM along with a rising titer of IgG along with low avidity gives you some idea that it is a recent infection and it may give you some clue. Unconventional treatments are used like gencyclovir or gencyclovir, long period of time, 6 months. You can see that syrups are not available. We have to use it from capsules. Is unconventional treatment like pyrimethamine, which we never use except malaria, sulfadiazine, which we never use, folinic acid, we never use, but unconventional treatments are being used. Herpes, acyclovir, we don't use that much in chickenpox, but in herpes, especially if herpes skin eye mold disease is coming within 6 to 10 days, you are expected to use acyclovir, and that also for 14 to 21 days, depending on whether you have involvement of CSF or not. Follow-up has to be done because these diseases, even if you treat them, cure them, they may continue to haunt the infant. They may have deafness later on in life also, even if the bera is normal initially. They may get retardation, mental retardation, neurodevelopmental issues later on, cataract may come up later on. You really have to follow them up to really take care of them. So prevention holds the key. Rubella can be really prevented by MMR vaccination, which is government is promoting MR vaccination. MR vaccination is part of our national immunization schedule. So MR vaccination comes in a bigger way. Rubella, like the Pan American Health Association, has already eradicated rubella and CRS from their continent. So we can also do that from rubella. Toxoplasmosis can be prevented by taking care of cat litter. Fortunately, we don't have that high disease burden. Herpes can be prevented by LSCS if it is active herpetic lesions in the genital area. CMV is a disease which is going to stay because CMV is not easily preventable. We are infection load. 90% of adults are seropositive. Some of them will get reactivation. And if that happens in pregnancy, definitely we keep on getting disease. Even Dr. Karthik will agree, we are seeing a lot of CMV because of blood transfusions, perinatal infections. So CMV is going to stay. We need to treat them aggressively. We need to use filters for blood transfusion so that perinatal transmission can be avoided. And the breast milk should not be used just like that after pasteurization, especially from donor milk, because that also can be a source of infection. So thank you so much. And I'll be very happy if there are some comments, questions from the esteemed panelists, Dr. Karthik, Dr. Naveen, Dr. Lallan, Dr. Anupam, and the participants.
Pankaj, that was just wonderful. Thank you so much. What a difficult task of comprise. I mean, you over a short period of time, the entire gamut of congenital infections, you carried out so well the presentation. Thank you. I would have one question I'm seeing on the question box. This is Dr. VK, who says, what quantitative value of DNA in urinary PCR for CMV is considered positive for treatment purposes in neonatal CMV hepatitis?
We have right. So that is depending on lab. So in our lab, they have cutoffs of something like this 13,000 or something value. So I don't remember exactly, but this depends on the lab. So in the amniotic fluid, any value is abnormal, but in urinary, there's a cutoff. So it's a very low value, like 33 or something is taken as negative, and more than that is taken as positive. So yes, you have to check your lab, which you are doing it for. So we are doing it at two places in Gangaram Hospital. Microbiology lab has different cutoff, and the genetic lab also does it, which is a different cutoff.
Great. Thank you.
Dr. Pankaj, it was an excellent presentation. You really summed it. It is otherwise a very long scene reading torch infection or listening to the lectures, but you have summed up very important clinical points, diagnosis as well as the management. Before we go to the audience, I have one question from my side.
Please.
Is there any role of repeat PCR to decide about the length of treatment for CMV infections? That for how long we should be giving it?
See, there was a thought process that if it is an infection which is involving the lungs, pneumonitis, or brain encephalitis, then you can repeat a CSF to show that it is a falling titer, especially if you're using IV gencyclovir, and because you may be using IV gencyclovir for pneumonitis or for brain infection, then after 2 weeks, you can do a sample to show that it has started showing response, and then you can switch to valganciclovir. But that is also debated. Most experts will agree that you will require 6 months of treatment. Gencyclovir has got 1/3 patients will get neutropenia. It is side effects are much more. So many experts will say that only use valganciclovir and use it for 6 months, and there's no point documenting that the CMV burden has come down. But sometimes what you do is that you are looking for a diagnosis and the child has got multiple issues going on. You're not sure whether you are treating with valganciclovir or he's got other diseases which are also there. So you may be checking it otherwise to show that yes, valganciclovir is working and the child is not work is doing fine. So maybe some other disease is also there in this child. So there may be those anecdotes in which you need to repeat PCR, especially urine or amniotic fluid. But otherwise, I read up this topic very recently from Red Book also. They are also saying that there is no routine recommendation of repeating PCR in urine sample to show a benefit of the therapy.
And what about our take on giving breast milk to the baby, the mothers who are positive for CMV, same mother baby, not other mother's milk, same own mother's milk, to the baby who are positive for CMV infections? And we don't know at birth whether the baby has got CMV infection, transplacental spread or not. And we are, what is our take and what is our, what our answer should be to the mother who is asking us the question that giving breast milk to the baby will infect him or her?
So if I understood your question correctly, you're saying that you know that the mother is
Mother
infected
is
with CMV
all, yeah.
and his her breast milk has CMV. So you have tested the
Yeah.
breast milk, you know it is CMV positive. Now the answer to that question is that it depends on the baby status. If it's a term baby, which is expected to be immunocompetent host, then a term baby getting breast milk, even if he gets infection, it may get infection. As I said, 5 to 15% breast milk can spread infection. It is not going to cause any damage to the term newborn. But if it is a preterm newborn, then it can get hepatitis, it can get all those issues, though the severity is much less than that of congenital infections. But then that is a debate you need to do with the mother that whether you want to have that bit of risk, that 5 to 15%, or you want the benefits of breast milk, which may be much more for a preterm baby, as we know that NAC reduction and mortality reduction is so high. So that will be 1:1 discussion with the mother, whether a preterm situation she wants to continue breastfeeding or a second option can be offered. But a full-term baby, no risk now.
Taking it further, is there any role of giving milk infected CMV milk in the same scenario and giving gencyclovir prophylactically to that baby? Is there, is
So
it comes in that in the scenario? Have you encountered such situations or?
I have not, but I can say that what is done that sometime that happens in the transplant unit. So suppose you have done a transplant and later on you came to know that CMV was positive in the donor. And though the patient has not got the disease, but then these transplant recipients, they keep on receiving valganciclovir for a very long period of time as a prophylactic chemoprophylaxis. But the concept is similar for baby also, but I don't think so we'll be using it. It's a potentially toxic drug, will not be used for prevention or chemoprophylaxis for in newborns, because ultimately even 1/5 patient will get absolute neutropenia, and which can be a trouble. So I will say that if it is a donor milk, pasteurize it. At the worst scenario can be that if the mother's own milk, you pasteurize it and give if you're really scared, if you're scared about, because pasteurization really takes care of CMV very well.
No, just adjunct to that question, most of the population in the general population would be CMV positive, isn't it?
Positive.
So lady who would be pregnant, then what are we discussing now? I couldn't answer, understand.
Naveen is saying you tested the milk, breast milk of that baby. The breast milk is, because PCR can be done, it is positive for CMV. So whether to breastfeed from a CMV positive breast milk baby.
Any mother, are we not, then why should we do it? Any mother could be.
Yeah.
If she's asymptomatic and otherwise healthy looking, why should we even screen her?
Absolutely. I agree. We should not be screening it unnecessarily to increase the complexity of our care.
Absolutely. So you've got very interesting three questions here. I think they're all very similar. So if you see the question box, Dr. Senthil Kumar is asking if we usually see two, or sometimes it happens, two or more diseases are positive in the torch test. What do we do? What is the significance?
I think that is what I'm saying, that usually what happens is that if you get a test, Toxo IgG, Rubella IgG, CMV IgG, or everything is positive. That only tells us that the mother has got all these infections sometime in their life, which is possible because of two reasons, that maybe she's got all the infection like Toxo also, CMV also, and Rubella also, which is possible. Other possibility is that these antibodies are heterophile antibodies. So you may be positive for one, but if you test for others also, it may come IgG positive. So I will say that if it is IgG positive coming, it is coming from the mother. It is only telling us the mother status. If it is one positive, two positive, or three positive, no significance attached to it. If it is fitting into your scenario, if the signs and symptoms are fitting, then you repeat a IgG specifically after 2 weeks and see if it's a rising titer. You can do an avidity test to show it's a low avidity. So it is not from the mother, it is the baby's own IgG. And you also do IgM. So if you don't have PCR, then if you do all three, some indication may come. But otherwise, IgG only is not an issue because of heterophile antibodies and because it is coming from the mother.
Yeah, the similar question is, how much increase in IgG titers after 2 weeks you would say is significant?
So I think I'm also a little confused on this answer, because the Red Book says that you see rising titers after 2 weeks. Usually we used to say four times the titer, but that is not written in the Red Book of 2021. So that is only saying rising titer. So that means that we are not looking at fourfold or something like that. It is just the rising titer, which we are saying that they are significant.
Okay. I have one question of my own to ask you. You didn't probably cover Zika virus, but has it sort of increased in incidence? Because we have been seeing a couple of them recently also. So what do you think? What's your take?
So I will be very interested in listening to your comments on that, because I have not seen I have not diagnosed. I only read in newspapers that Zika virus came in, I think, Bangalore or Kerala. So if you can,
Because it was a severely microcephalic baby. For no reason, the baby was picked up antenatally with microcephaly, which brings me again to the point that many, many perinatal infections you can pick up antenatally. Because most of our fetal medicine is very strong nowadays. So in book mothers, we find growth retardation, you say intracerebral calcification, you sometimes see some, other kind of markers like what you mentioned for any intrauterine infection, even antenatally. So this child was picked up antenatally with severe microcephaly. So we could therefore pick up. But then the child is on follow-up, and unfortunately, the prognosis doesn't look very good. So Dr. Ravi Datta here, Ravi Das Sharma is mentioning here, the treatment and diagnosis of congenital syphilis, another forgotten disease probably.
I think, I've not touched that because I thought that we are not diagnosing many. And, treatment and diagnosis of congenital syphilis will require a full session. Because syphilis here is, you have to diagnose by VDRL is passively positive. You have to do FTA, ABS, and then you have to treat with the CPEN. You have to do CSF examination also. So I've not dealt with that, but that will require a more detailed discussion.
So just a curiosity, COVID-related, any kind of increase in incidence of any perinatal complications you have been seeing, or?
See, when we saw COVID in 2021, we had a lot of patients who were one of the COVID centers. and we had a lot of deliveries which happened COVID positive mothers. But fortunately, we did not see any vertical transmission from the COVID mothers to the newborns. We did isolate them. We did investigate them. They had none. We did see some newborns coming to us after discharge because of horizontal transmission. And they also did not have much mobility or any major issues in early infancy or neonatal period. So the vertical transmission was not very common with COVID. Fortunately, children as a large group and infants in particular were not severely affected by even the horizontal transmission of COVID.
No, just as a side issue to this, we have been seeing a lot of multi-inflammatory syndrome of newborns, MISM, where the mother has COVID in the pregnancy and the antibodies get transmitted to the baby and the child ends up with multi-organ dysfunction. And it becomes quite a difficult thing to diagnose unless you do an echo and find some evidence of coronary arterial dilatation or increase in the cardiac biomarkers. So we have had multiple such cases of MISN. So not technically, it's not technically a congenital infection. If you look at the definition of the kind, it's not as if transplacently transmitted virus itself, but the antibodies when they're transmitted and there's an autoinflammatory cascade which occurs in the newborn baby that leads to this syndrome. Have you been seeing any cases of MISN or something?
So we did see few, but I will say that I'm not talking particularly about cases which you have seen. I'm sure you ruled out other possibilities. So in the time of 21 and 22, when everybody on the earth had COVID, if you test any newborn, it will get antibodies because the mother did get infection at some point of time. And I saw a lot of patients at that time which were referred to us like Miss C or Miss C, that which is childhood multi-system inflammatory disorder, and because antibodies were positive. And when we investigated them, we found many other diagnoses which were there, which were responsible for their multi-organ dysfunction, and antibody was just a coincidental finding. Maybe some of them may be really having this, but as a group at Gangaram Hospital, we did not get a lot of these patients of Miss C in newborn, which were only attributable to COVID. They had other diagnoses in most of them.
Can I come in here, please?
Yes.
Yeah, yes, sure, yes. Sir.
I recently reviewed an article for a foreign journal on pediatric hematology and oncology, and it was showing that in a span of 2 years or 3 years after this COVID period, the incidence of pulmonary thrombosis in children has gone up, and they had reported somewhere around 30, 34 patients. I mean, that is also one thing which one has to keep in mind. I mean, it's not anything to do with torch, but if you get a patient, something like that, you must keep in mind that this there's a procoagulant situation. And, even recently, one of our colleagues' wives, now, I'm not talking of pediatric patient, but an adult patient was discovered with pulmonary thrombosis in post-COVID kind of a thing. So COVID is a very
funny disease.
It's a very yes. funny virus. Yes. And we have yet to understand its gamut of its effects on the body. And as we know that there has been a spate of deaths in young people who are doing vigorous exercise or something of that sort post-COVID, and they just collapsed. And, so that is another aspect which one has to look into and, try to sort out. In fact, we are trying to put together a study with the help of INCLEN to look at post-COVID, give them, who were admitted in the COVID thing, and give them calls, ring them up, and ask them specific questions to look at these aspects. So we are planning that study with the help of INCLEN and the ministry. The gamut of the disease has yet to be fully understood.
Correct, correct. That's, we have a lot of things to learn.
One other disease, sorry, I'm just interjecting, Pankaj. Dengue, you know, when a mother has active dengue with fever during the peripartum period, we do expect and we do screen babies for dengue, but we can easily miss. In fact, we published some time back that we can miss neonatal dengue in the initial screening because a newborn dengue can take about easily one at the end of 1 week or even 14 days to clinically present. So at the time of birth, when even if you know the mother has fever due to dengue, you screen and do an NS1 in the baby, it may not come positive. We may miss that window period to screen between 5 to 7 days because most babies would have gone home. So this is another challenge we always we need to remember, and this we published some time ago, that we need to ask parents to come back for a rescreening because some babies have come back in a sometimes on a hemodynamic collapse also in our institution. So this is another thing probably maybe you
Absolutely, absolutely. That's right. That is correct. Because you know
So
that dengue can.
there's another question in the question box, and it is by Dr. VK, who has written that what are chances of recurrence and affecting the baby by CMV and toxoplasma in subsequent pregnancy if it affected in previous pregnancy?
Right. So this is a very important question because what happens is the obstetricians, they look for Torch-Guber infections if it is a recurrent abortion-like situation. Something happened in the first pregnancy again. So the chances of recurrence and affecting the baby by CMV in subsequent pregnancy is very low. So as I said, that primary CMV infection risk is higher. Second infection is only 2 to 4% or 1-3% only, but it can affect. But it's very less common. Similarly, toxoplasmosis in the subsequent pregnancy risk is very less, and rubella will never happen. So these two is less, rubella nil. So don't think too much on that line because you have to really work hard to make that diagnosis, which is not easy in this situation. I think I can read a next question also,
Yeah,
Dr.
please.
Karthik.
Yeah.
If mother had no Torch screening available, but baby had IgG titer positive along with symptom, I think, should it be wise to say Torch positive if IgG is rising titer? So more mother Torch screening you don't need. You know, if your baby has got IgG titer positive, that means baby is either making its own antibody or the it's transferred from the mother. Because baby is already getting passive antibodies from the mother. So if baby's IgG is positive, it only tells her tells that the mother is already infected and it's transferring his antibody to the baby. So if their symptoms is compatible with Torch-Guber infection, then you have to document IgM positivity, a rising titer of IgG, a low avidity. Then it makes your suspicion stronger. And to really confirm the diagnosis, you still need a PCR.
Thank you so much. One comment from Dr. Jaleel Ahmed from Coimbatore. He's a very senior neonatologist. Dr. Jaleel, can you kindly unmute yourself and make that comment, please? Is that possible for me?
Can I request the admin to upgrade Dr. Jaleel as a panelist? Sushil, can you make
Ashish.
Dr. Jaleel Ahmed as a panelist?
Is
Yes, sir.
Sushil.
Make her, sir.
Okay,
Ahmed. Thank you.
right. He's there. Jaleel is there.
Hello,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
Sir, I must
Hello.
say namaste and salams to Pankaj sir and my guru Karthik sir also and all the neonatal stalwarts, sir. Actually, this Torch infection, so many times, I have more than 3 decades of neonatal practice. This is the old wine available in only in the old bottle. So I'm asking this among the all the perinatal or whatever the congenital infection, the O stands for other. As Dr. Karthik Nag has mentioned, we can always include the COVID, Zika, chikungunya, and the dengue. All are easily manageable also, number one. Whereas this toxo and CMV, you have properly mentioned about the rising IgG with the low avidity. If these labs are maintaining or telling the result of low avidity, sir, any lab to confirm or
Yes.
to continue the treatment? I don't think so. The labs, unless we ask, they don't give it. because of the repeated stillbirth, repeated pregnancy losses, the mothers bring with the report of elevated, almost all the elevated IgG, when then the obstetrician or ourselves finding a dilemma whether to treat or not. But still, I feel by treating the CME or toxo, is it worth, sir?
So, thank you for that question, Dr. Jaleel. So, first of all, because your video is showing autism ki baat community ke saath. So let me make a comment that
I know.
So I have a comment. Right. So CRS, congenital rubella syndrome, is one of the very, very well established cause of autism. So let me say that autism is connected to at least congenital rubella syndrome. Now coming back to your question. That's correct that rising titers alone should not give you an idea that this is CMV or toxo or for that matter any. So I said that if you have IgM positive, rising titer and low avidity, if all three are there, then it's possibly one of those infections. But the gold standard still remains a PCR. Like which labs are doing avidity? Lal Laboratories doing avidity testing for CMV and for rubella. Gangaram Hospital, we are also doing avidity for rubella as well as CMV. So if you have to assign a lab which is doing it, but I will suggest that I think try to get a lab which is doing PCR for this group like toxo, CMV, rubella, parvo, syphilis, because ultimately PCR is going to be the game changer. Once you are making the even if you're looking at Zika, you're looking at corona, we are looking at all these viruses, who will make really confirm the diagnosis? It will be coming from PCR. So we have to really strengthen our labs, microbiology or genetics, which are doing PCR multiplex technology to really diagnose these infections which was not diagnosed before. So rather than serology, we should invest in PCR to make the diagnosis.
I must ask you and Dr. Karthik Nagar, you have a personal experience of those babies treated in the neonatal period. Now they've grown up. Is there any cases like you have in your personal experience, intact survival? CME and toxo. CME and toxo. I'm not talking about other. I treated one toxo, repeated the siblings affected. Very pathetic family, a Muslim family, and all the treated with the obstetrician correctly, and all the siblings they suffered from toxo. Similarly, I treated once cytomegalovirus with gamcyclovir. That baby collapsed at the end of sixth month in a liver failure. So that was the history from my side.
So I have not treated toxoplasmosis, I only treated one toxoplasmosis, but that also was diagnosed not in neonatal period, but diagnosed around 5-6 months of age. He had got hepatosplenomegaly and he's got thrombocytopenia. He did not have calcifications in the brain. That child we treated for 1 year with pyrimethamine, and that child did well. Fortunately, he did not have serious disease. As a CMV is concerned, I have treated number of congenital CMV infections. It is in our collective follow-up. They do have sensorineural deafness and developmental delays, but because it was diagnosed in time, they are still being managed properly. We are seeing a lot of postnatally acquired CMV in the NICUs. We treat them and they do exceedingly well. So there's not a problem with postnatally acquired one. Congenital ones, definitely it's a problem, but early diagnosis can really make their lives better.
Sir, among the two, cytomegalovirus and toxo, the toxo is a very, very dangerous culprit because the have you tried that? Because the OBGs, they tried the schizomycin instead of pyrimethamine.
Pyrimethamine, I see. Good. I've not.
Dr. Karthik.
Yeah, Dr. Karthik.
No, I must confess, I have a very similar experience as what Dr. Pankaj said. Lots of CMV virus infections we have gone through, but I can't remember really a seriously confirmed toxoplasma virus, toxoplasma protozoa, but CMV definitely. And the prognosis neurodevelopmentally, CMV is not very good. And CMV hepatitis especially is very devastating. But I can't often remember any congenital toxoplasmosis.
Fortunately for us, because we don't have cats or as our pets usually. So maybe that's the reason, because we also not seeing toxo that much.
This toxo is a unique infection. Once you entered, it is very difficult to eradicate for the subsequent pregnancy also.
Maybe. I have very limited personal experience with toxo.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Pankaj sir. Long time I have seen you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your nice words.
Yes, sir.
So even at the end of presentation, we have more than 50 participants. That means that even at 10 o'clock, 10, 12, people are still listening to us. That's something good. Over to you, Dr. Anupam, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Anupam, Dr. Pankaj, and to IAP Delhi for inviting me and getting me this good opportunity to listen to this great talk. Thank you so much. And Dr. Anupam, is he going to conclude or has he?
He's not. That's fine. You're going to conclude, no problem.
Thank you so much. It was a great experience and a great learning, Pankaj. Thank you. And I'm sure people would have benefited a lot from this talk. Thank you, Dr.
Kartik, Dr. Naveen, and a special thanks to Dr. Jaleel Ahmed from Coimbatore. Thank you very much for your inputs. It was a pleasure for getting your inputs. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Namaskar. Namaskar.
Bye-bye.